This is CBS.
Don't touch that dial. We're going to take you behind the scenes at Hollywood horror movies. And you're going to meet my friend here, plus the creators of Hellraiser and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Ooh, next on People Are Talking.
The Adventure. Mac and Muttley, Saturday at 7.
Live from San Francisco, it's Channel 5's People Are Talking with Ann Fraser and Rock McGowan.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome to People Are Talking. We are back in the studio after our 3 days at the Circle Star. Actually, it wasn't 3 days. We taped all three shows from the Circle Star Theater in one day.
Yeah, on Tuesday we started at, well, doing our live show at 10 o'clock, and then two shows after that. Throughout the day, something like 6,000 of you came to watch the three shows.
And you were wonderful, we want to say. Our audiences
very
out there
patient.
They were patient yeah. And enthusiastic, and we really appreciated them turning out.
Why don't you show them just a little bit of what we did at the Circle Star in case you missed it.
Here's a little bit of the chips, a little bit of the Lacage. Take a look. That's scary.
You love the bump.
And, wonderful.
You love the bump and grind too. That you weren't ready for the guys to come up and dance with you.
Dance with me, I wasn't. But you know what? Whatever's fair. I loved it. Boy, we had a good time,
so
and hopefully we'll do this again next year because
it
was a great time.
And thank you again to everybody down at the Circle Star. A really cooperative group, and we had fun. We shall return. I want Tom Lemus, our sound man here at Channel 5, to play something for you, and kind of get your reaction. Well, I probably know what your reaction is going to be when you hear it. Tom, would you play the sound? Huh? Yeah, you get the feeling that somebody is soon to be attacked by a killer shark. It is chilling music. It is violent and it is scary, but Jaws is no match for the contemporary horror stories and films of today. Sometime referred to as the Splat Pack Movement. And the writers of this Splat Pack Movement take great pride in writing horrific detail and gory violence. And one of the most famous of the current writers is Clive Barker. And Clive, before we talk to you, let's show, this is your first film. This is called Hellraiser, and it gives a little flavor of what Clive tries to produce for you. Watch this. Take great pride. I can see you watching the monitor there.
Kids.
Those are your kids. What, do you want as much graphic detail in the violence and in the gore as you can get?
No. No, I don't think the graphicness is the point. The point is
that there have to be stories that people can relate to. There have to be situations that can get people excited. Graphicness isn't really the issue. The issue is getting people involved and then making them jump. It's got to be a roller coaster ride. You've got to deliver. If people put down their $7 to see the movie, and they're seeing a horror movie, they don't want to see Little Mermaid. I want to give them their money's worth and more. I always want to be a little bit ahead of that expectation, a little bit beyond what they think they can take.
Clive, you say we all need monsters. I don't know why.
Why? Because there's a little bit of the monstrous, a little bit of the monstrous in us all, including yourself, and
I'm sure.
Really, I seriously think we all of us have in our dreamscapes, in our dream lives, dark things, things we suppress, things we fears about ourselves, about our body corrupting, about the way our body is constantly trying to thrust itself out of our control. We're dealing with those fears all the time in our dreams.
So is that where you get your ideas? Do you explore, like, sleep and nightmares and dreams?
I keep a dream diary. I believe in lucid dreaming, yes. And I am...
So like what we just saw on the screen where the guy's putting the weird two fingers in her mouth,
well,
looks like he's going to rip her jaw. You dream about
Let
stuff like that?
Let me ask you the other question. You have nightmares, right, once in a while? Come on.
Whoa, sure. Yeah, I have nightmares. I can't remember one right now, but yes, I have nightmares.
And nightmares, I think, are a legitimate way of dealing with anxieties which are going through our heads in our waking lives. I think we have to deal with them in all kinds of ways, sometimes in sleep, sometimes in the movies, which is like a waking dream.
Helplessness is something that always is a part of a nightmare, isn't
sure.
it? I mean, you're helpless. You can't run fast enough. You can't write down what you want. You can't say what you want.
Yeah.
And try to recreate that in film?
I think we all of us feel helpless. We get born into this helpless condition. The first thing we know, we're hanging upside down. Our backsides are being slapped. That's pretty helpless. And I don't think it gets much better than that, frankly. I think we go through our lives finding ourselves prone to all kinds of pressures. Love takes hold of us. Adolescence takes hold of us. Middle age takes hold of us. Our bosses, our jobs, all kinds of things take hold of us, and we feel powerless in their grip. We have to deal with the anxieties that kind of stirs up in us.
Do you know who is sitting next to Clive? David Schow. And do you know what he wrote? Leatherface, Texas Chainsaw Massacre number 3. Oh, you're proud of that one, aren't you, David? I mean, you are proud of that one.
Well, I engage chainsaws more than I engage pride. So.
Can we get a shot of what you're wearing on your lapel?
Because can we see this? Yes.
This is a chainsaw. And I assume that you want these kind of movies to be as gory as possible.
Well, not as gory as possible just for gore's sake. What I'm trying to do is engage intensity on whatever level that speaks to whatever the story needs to punch it across as hard as possible. And that can be an intellectual intensity, it can be an emotional intensity, or sometimes it can be a visceral intensity. And that's how we wind up with the red, wet stuff all over the place.
Let me ask you a question. Isn't sometimes it better not to see it? You know, you see the chainsaw just kind of starting to hit the person, and then you go away mm-hmm. and hear the screams. Is that worse than actually seeing all this red stuff splattered all over the camera?
Oh, I believe sometimes less is more. That's true, but why should I choose? I think that we can have both. Sometimes more is more.
Are you ever concerned that this violence that we're seeing on the screen, and I know you get asked this all the time, is going to give ideas to the real
people
person
that are
out
not
there?
Playing with a full deck?
It's almost, it's a question that's asked so often that we almost have a standard response to it, which is that people who are apt to do that sort of thing could be set off by anything. My favorite example is around the turn of the century, there was a murderer in Germany named Peter Curtin, known as the Dusseldorf Vampire. He killed 36, 37 various people in various ways with hammers, and he lured people into parks and he murdered them. There were two interesting things about Peter Curtin. The first thing is that he missed as many as he hit. In other words, he would lure some woman into the park, bash her in the head with a hammer, they would run away. And the other thing was that he claimed that the thing that set him off was listening to the Catholic High Mass.
Ah!
So perhaps we should make sure that no one hears the Catholic High Mass because it's dangerous and could set one of these lunatics off.
So you're saying that a lunatic can be set off by anything?
By anything, by Flintstones cartoons.
Yeah, to do something like that. But don't you think that perhaps your films give them some creative options?
Possibly, but for people lacking imagination, if they didn't do it with a knife, they would do it with a club. If they didn't do it with a club, they would drop a television set from a great height and bash someone.
So you're saying that they'd be their own crazy, creative
I think it's a mistake to make creative people culpable for what lunatics do.
We got to take a commercial break. We'll be back and talk more about horror films right after this.
Hold still. Come on. No, it's okay. It's all right.
Hurry, please. Bring her. Please bring her to me. Pay no attention. Just give her to me.
It's harvest. Northside Theater Company presents After the Rain at San Jose's Olinder Theater. Call for details.
I must say that when I went to see that film and they first were searching through those little pod fields and that thing smacked up, that little creature smacked up on that person's face and then went down their throat.
You loved it, didn't you?
No, yeah. That was it for me. That was absolutely terrifying. Is there a different kind of, I mean, someone in our audience said, you know, I like the psychological horror stories, but I don't like it being real graphic. Are there various categories in your way of thinking?
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I think everybody sitting here does more than one kind of horror. It would be a different thing if we were just engaged in throwing, like, buckets of viscera into the viewer's face, fictionally or in the movies that we do. But fortunately for us and for you, we do more than one kind.
What kind of kids were you?
Here I am. I'm still the kid.
I'm a product of The Untouchables, watching reruns of The Untouchables, which was the most violent show on television at that time. More deaths per hour than any other television show.
But were you considered by the other kids as kind of weird?
No, they watched the monster movies with me.
Did you date a lot?
The other kids when I was 5 years old?
Well, kids, younger, teenager. Did you have girlfriends? Who was the one that the minister's daughter said, you ain't going out with him anymore? Was that you, Clive?
That was me.
Oh, was that you, Howard?
Yeah, that was, I had always made monsters when I was a kid. Started at about 10 years old, and when I was in high school, it was almost, I think she was the first girl I ever dated, and I was like 18 years old. And her father was a minister and said, you're not going out with my daughter. You're satanic. You're evil. And I'm like, what do you mean? I'm just having fun. I'm just playing. What does this have to do with being satanic or evil?
But you created that wonderful little friend next to you. Who is that?
This is actually a creature for a film called Tales from the Dark Side, the movie. That'll be out in April. And that's exactly what he is, my friend. I mean, every morning I go into my shop and, good morning, how you doing? It's that way with all my creatures.
This is Howard Berger from K&B Effects.
But Howard, I mean, you consider them your friends. Is it because you make these creatures and then they're your friends and so you don't get scared?
Right. I create what these men write. They come from my imagination as well as the writer's imagination.
Can you make him move again?
Sure.
If we could have... You do it... You know the boats you take out and the little model airplanes you fly with the remote control? That's how you work...
Yeah, we have to see, because
here.
He blinked at me during the pre-show tease.
So can we show the remote control unit, Hal?
Yeah, this is the remote control unit.
So it's the same kind
airplanes.
Of unit that you use for the model airplanes,
right.
Can
the
you
model
make it
boats out? And all.
Do anything?
Yeah, let's do his mouth here.
Let's do his mouth.
Oh, you've got different controls
and you know
for
what?
Each one.
As he, oh, look at that. Look. Oh, now what are you putting on it? You're putting on a head apparatus?
Yeah, this is a head apparatus. It's called the Waldo unit.
And so you would put this apparatus
on? You would strap this on your head, and by opening your jaw, we'll open the monster's jaw.
So he would mimic your movements?
Correct.
So is it this way so you can do the mouth and do the eyes and everything at the same
right.
time?
Although you have different operators. There's like, it took, I think, four people to operate this one monster on set.
Uh-huh.
You had a person that did the eyes and the lids and the brows. You had a person that did the jaw and the lips. You had a person that did the tongues and the cheek. And this was a full suit. An actor wore this. He was strapped into it every day for 14 hours. And we also had gigantic wings that were operated off screen.
So if you're working the tongue, how do you know when to work?
we have to stay in the shop and rehearse this. We have
so it's like choreography
dialogue.
Then, isn't it?
Very much.
It's
very
choreographed.
Much. We just don't go on set and wing it. Just
right.
out there
yeah.
doing the thing.
Oh, now we're looking at some other monsters here.
Oh, this is
yeah,
the gargoyle.
That's the monster. This is the finished head that you see here. This is the actor in the suit. The actor was 6'4". I wanted to cast a real big guy. I think there's some footage coming up of the finished monster. This is in the shop, just a test day.
So he doesn't have the rest of his uniform or costume.
Right, he is wearing a suit, but it's unpainted here.
Ah. Now, do we have the rest of it? We don't have the rest of it.
I guess not. Well, anyhow, he's completely painted in this paint scheme.
How much does it cost to develop a head like this?
This head is about $20,000.
Wow.
Just because of the time spent on it. It took 8 weeks, which is incredibly quick, actually, to build this head and the suit also.
And if you touch it, it's...
Yeah, it's very
real.
Fleshy. I mean, it's made of a foam latex material, which a lot of the creatures are made out of.
Now, we have a clip from The Nightmare on Elm Street. Do you want to set this up for us, Howard? This is the head splitting.
Sure. What? This is the a sequence in Nightmare on Elm Street Part 5. It's one of the end sequences where Freddy stretches out of the lead actress, Alice. We did a series of three different heads and a mechanical body that Robert Englund, who plays Freddy, could burst out of.
Now, we should point out here, this is very graphic, so if this kind of thing makes you queasy, you may not want to watch it. Watch.
Is it about that character? Kids love Freddy.
Yeah, people love Freddy.
I mean, they love Freddy. Now, you've got to be out of your mind to love that. I mean, how come, how in the world can we love something like that? Where did that love...
Well, I think...
Wait just a minute. I have an audience member here who can hardly wait to tell me. Stand up here.
Well, those fears are in all of us, and as children, we know that since they come from inside of us, that we should love them anyway. And as we get older, we lose that. And I think that these movies are a way of getting back in touch with that point where you and your fears are one, and it's okay.
But at the same time, do these movies, if that's true, keep us young?
Yes. I genuinely think they're good for you. I genuinely think they're therapeutic.
Anybody?
I think I aged when I saw Alien. I don't think they kept me young.
Linda.
I got to tell you, I saw Psycho as a teenager, and I still have problems taking a shower if no one is home. I've got two boys at home that love this stuff. I mean, they love Freddy.
And do you fear that it may have lasting effects
exactly.
that Psycho did on you?
Who are they going to be when they grow up?
Well, you seem okay.
I still can't take a shower alone.
But that is a very good point. If I'm in the home alone and you're taking a shower, you think about it, don't you, Linda?
But
not that we take showers together, but I've never met Linda, folks.
But in a hotel room, it's even scarier.
But we make a distinction here between Linda's talking about a movie which, despite its strange conclusions, is nevertheless a realistic movie. This is about a woman who's alone in a motel, and she gets stabbed in the shower. Most of the people in this row here are making what I would call fantastical horror movies of one kind or another. The movie you just saw, Nightbreed, which comes out today, is a movie I directed. It's very strange. It's full of monsters. Nothing you are ever going to meet in your shower, honestly. The stuff we just saw from Nightmare on Elm Street, Freddy, that stuff is fantastical. It's dream stuff. It just isn't going to invade your house. And I think there are distinctions we made. We started the question before, Ross, about whether there were levels, and I think there are.
Okay.
When we come back, we'll meet another person. who's got a history of horror in his family.
Mom, sugar's one part of your kid's diet, and you don't need the supplement. That's why they're sugar-free Bugs Bunny. All four Bugs Bunny chewable vitamins help complete their balanced diets. With no sugar, artificial flavors, or preservatives added.
Mom and kids love Bugs Bunny because it's sugar-free.
It was with great honor that I led a tribute to the town baker, Mr. Thomas. I didn't know the man, but I knew his muffins.
Thomas's English muffins, England's breakfast tradition, in America's hands.
Had Mr. Thomas been here to see my harvest, he might have made an English muffin with oat bran. But alas, he went off to America.
New delicious Thomas's oat bran English muffins. Their time has come.
Want to give yourself a treat? You want a taste that can't be beat? Have a little sunshine.
Sunshine.
Bunch, you can have it all. You're having no cholesterol. Have a little sunshine.
Sunshine.
Just about every cookie and cracker Sunshine makes has absolutely no cholesterol. Now what could be better than sunshine?
Have a little sunshine.
Have a little sunshine.
Have a little sunshine.
Hi, I'm Joan London, and I read something that convinced me that Beech Nut Stage is baby food is the best. They're labels. I became a beech nut mother because only Beech Nut Stages has unique quality ingredients like Chiquita bananas and Regal Imperial carrots. I wanted only the very best for our daughter, and no modified tapioca starch like you'll find in other leading brands. So give your baby Beech Nut Stages, the right food at the right stage. Compare labels yourself. There is a difference with Beech Nut Stages.
You can voice your opinion on controversial issues and hot topics by being part of the People Are Talking audience. Call 478-KPIX for tickets and let your voice be heard.
Difficult to walk down the street alone on a dark night when you see movies like that. David, you had a question.
Yeah, I have a question for the audience, basically. In comparison to our current roster of monsters that is...
For the audience to say, uh-huh, yes, uh-huh. David.
Yeah, yeah.
You're being very casual.
Pretend you can't see this little fashion accessory here. As compared to today's roster of current series movies monsters like Jason and Freddy and Michael Myers and Halloween and Leatherface and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, how many of you feel that the monsters of the Universal Pictures of the 40s, Frankenstein and the Wolfman and the Mummy, are comparatively benign compared to these creatures? In other words, the monsters we have today, do you feel they're worse?
Oh, I was saying that I think that the movies, you know, when I was younger and I saw those movies, they were really scary. But the movies of today, when I walk out of the theater, I'm a nervous wreck. So I think they're much more bloody and gory, whereas the others were terrifying, but it's the blood and gore
so these movies,
the temporary ones.
So these movies are having the same effect today that Frankenstein had in 1931 when it was released, because they had ambulances and stuff outside the theater. People were fainting. They had to be escorted from the theater. They had never seen anything like that before. And that's kind of what we're doing here now. We're trying to show you, it's much harder to show you now something you've never seen or couldn't possibly imagine than it was in 1931.
Yes.
I feel that some of the movies that are out, like Born on 4th of July, are just as violent.
Just not
in the scary mood.
The difference being, though, that is history. And not saying that it's necessarily right, but I think that is the kind of thing we can never forget. A war like that is important.
Okay. Hopefully it will be scary to us.
Then don't use an example. You want to know the film that scares the hell out of me? Lethal Weapon 2. Because in Lethal Weapon 2, Mel Gibson plays a gun-wielding psychotic that kills more people than die in all three Texas Chainsaw Massacre films.
John.
Exactly. And in, like you were talking about the Universal classics, they don't make films like that anymore. You know, instead of having a Frankenstein and a Dracula, you've got a Freddy and you've got a Jason, and they don't compare. Whereas some of the things like Clive's doing, the Pinhead, that's kind of bringing it back to where you have the monsters that you don't have in, you know, I don't consider the Jason and the Freddy, that's different. But when you bring out the original things and you're trying with the new ideas, now with Nightbreed, where it's focusing on monsters, you're trying to get back into that, and that's important
that is important.
You can only do so much of the stalk and slash.
Also with us this morning is Richard Matheson. You are ahead of the development division of Aaron Spelling down in Los Angeles. Your father is one of the founding fathers of horror of the 50s and 60s. What changes have you seen, Richard, over the years to now 1990 in horror films?
Well, I was thinking one of the things about it that I think disturbs people is that there is a kind of mocking sensibility about horror that wasn't there maybe 20 years ago.
What do you mean by that?
Well, that they're poking fun at their victims, that the monsters are,
Can I ask you, could you just move your microphone to your shirt, please, and I think we can hear you a little better.
Sure.
It's a little clip-on mic there. And
yeah.
Terrific. Go ahead.
How's that? Is that better?
Oh, well, if you'll talk a little, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
How's that?
That's good.
Okay. That, as we have all become desensitized to the various kinds of horror in our world, in the films, and so forth, that... how's it doing?
Well, we're going to take a commercial break and fix it. We'll be back in a moment. Yeah, don't go away. I think we got it. Hello?
The critics declare Men Don't Leave perfect, says Pat Collins. A movie to keep close to your heart. And Judith Crist says Jessica Lange triumphs in Men Don't Leave, rated PG-13. Sneak preview February 17th.
The ultimate international experience. For over 26 years, the nation's largest selection of quality international furniture. Scandinavian designs. Take-home dining from Italy for just $368. This camelback sofa and loveseat, both pieces, $699. Danish bookcases from $23 and $33. Teen sets from $159. Dressers as low as $49. Scandinavian designs. Your guide to international savings is in this weekend's paper. Look for it and remember where you can take home the world today for less. Scandinavian designs.
Washington apple time.
Time for the best apples of the year.
Ripe and good from the tree.
Washington apples with winter crunch.
Take a bite, come and find.
Washington apples.
Sweet goodness, come and see. Come share a taste of heaven, find as Mother Nature can grow. And your heart is gonna know. These are Washington apples.
Washington
sweet
apples.
And true as apples can be.
Bite into the best.
Most of the time, Remco customers rent things to own them. But sometimes, they bring things back. That's good news for you. Because these used but not abused items are fully serviced, given a 90-day limited warranty, and they're sold at up to 50% off. Which means, whenever Remco has a sale like this, things don't last very long. So come to Remco's used, not abused sale. All this week. Maybe.
Escape to the islands as evening travels to the Caribbean, the jet-setter's island of Mystique, an insider's view of Club Med, a beachcomber's view of, well, you'll see. Evening travels to paradise tonight at 7:30.
Channel 5 wants to acknowledge Bay Area teachers who are examples of excellence. To nominate your favorite teacher, check for details at all Bay Area public libraries and schools, or stop by any participating Apple computer retailer. Join us in saying thanks to teachers.
Oh, an oldie but goodie, The Creature from the Black Lagoon. Richard, you were talking about the differences between horror then.
Yeah, just to finish the point, a couple things. One is that, the world, as the world changes, the way horror is represented has to change. The each generation of creative people is going to be growing beyond what they were exposed to. And 10 years from now, it'll probably be much more savage and brutal. We will probably all seem like a very pastel trend. In 10 years.
I mean, we know that there are more mass murderers now.
Many more.
Many more,
yeah.
In the world now.
Yeah.
So does that element influence horror?
I think we should ask someone who was around at the time of Genghis Khan how many mass murderers there are now by comparison with them. I think we don't know that, you know.
I think it's because we are such a small world now, yeah, because of communications, yeah, that we're learning.
But I mean, if we've been, you know, if we've been in the sort of the plains of Asia in sort of 14 something or other, I think we wouldn't be as old as we are now. We would have been dead a long time ago.
Yeah.
Yes, I was going to ask you, how much blood and guts is too much blood and guts? Where do you draw the line?
Well, I think it's the ratings board who's drawing the line for us.
Unfortunately, that's true.
For instance, Chainsaw 3, which Dave wrote and my company did the special effects for, I'd say more than half of our effects were hacked out of the movie.
But, you know, it's not a coincidence that Howard is up here with us. I mean, part of what we're talking about is the sophistication of special effects.
Mm-hmm.
40 years ago, you just couldn't have pulled off something like American Werewolf in London. So part of what is happening is that people like Howard are coming in and making a huge difference. And that's what's causing it to be much more powerful.
Almost anything is possible.
Yeah.
We got four X's from the MPAA on Nightbreed. And each time an X is, you know, you can't send a movie out as an X, you have to get an R. And they say, no, you can't show that. And they send us back and we cut and we, and so on. At the end of the time, after four X's, the movie which, you know, is out on the screens today is 4.5 seconds shorter than it was before.
Right.
Now, I have to say, I don't think 4.5 seconds of anybody's special effects, however extraordinary they are, is going to corrupt anybody.
I think
people know that this is fiction. They know that this is fantastic.
Is there a chance you're going to get an X more because of violence or of sex?
In the case of Hellraiser, it was a combination of both that they objected
and
to.
And Betty has a question along those lines.
Is this a form of your sexual release, your orgasmic... do you get orgasms from creating and from watching?
God, I wish.
I love that. That would be
It's a very honest question, Betty. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Go ahead, Paul.
We'll work that out, Betty.
Yeah.
After that,
Betty, you know, Betty, that's a great idea.
The combination of eroticism and horror. I mean, there is.
John was talking before about monsters in the old style, okay? And one of the things I love about the old style monsters, something that I tried to do in Nightbreed, is put in monsters who are kind of sexy. And I think when I was a kid, I wanted to be Dracula. I didn't want to be the guy with the holy water and the crucifix, Van Helsing. Who would go and see a movie called Van Helsing, the movie?
Mm-hmm.
You know? You go see Dracula. You go see Dracula because he can seduce virgins across a crowded room, because he lives forever, because, you know, he can turn to a wolf. Any bad news so far? I mean, this seems pretty good to me. And now the trouble with the modern crop of horror villains, it seems to me, is for the most part, they're very unattractive. I mean, Freddy Krueger, you can't see Michael Myers' face, you can't see these guys. They're not exactly, you know, good party people.
And they punish the teenagers who are sexual.
They punish, yeah. Whereas the old tradition, certainly the Dracula tradition, I think it's very sexy. I'm trying to make Nightbreed very sexy.
There's Freddy and there's Jason and even the creature from the Black Lagoon. Are there any female counterparts?
There are a few. I mean, Dracula had his brides. But I don't think there are a large number. In Hellraiser, I had and the two Hellraiser pictures, I had some very dangerous women.
Why aren't there some women counterparts?
In Dallas.
There have got to be women out there.
Virginia wants to know about women, too.
I just wanted to ask why it seems so often that women are the victims. I don't know if they're more so than the men, but it seems to me...
I think it's changing now, yeah.
I think it's changing.
Yeah. But it's true.
But I think it's predominantly being a male audience that's seen these movies, and I think that is changing a little bit as well.
Let me ask you, are there any taboos in writing horror? Are there taboos? Are there things you will not do, like baby killing? And
I wouldn't write about Auschwitz. I wouldn't write about anything which touched upon somebody's present-day anxieties or memories. I think that would be...
So you don't write on historical events?
No, I would say that was bad taste.
But
in the realm of fantasy, guys, the realm of the weird, the stuff that's going on in our imaginations, do whatever, forbid your imagination nothing. Why? It's one of our greatest faculties.
So you would show maybe babies being killed?
I wouldn't show it. It might imply it. In Nightbreed, I imply a child is killed. I don't show it.
Mm-hmm.
John Stanley is with us, film critic for the San Francisco Chronicle. You're a horror movie buff. I mean, you love them, don't you?
I'm on a crusade, Ross. In the last 4 or 5 years, I have tried to see almost every horror, science fiction, and fantasy movie that's been released for the purposes of my creature feature movie guide. I sort of feel obligated now that the books coming out every 3 or 4 years to see as many of these films as I can. So I have the joy of seeing the, all these people have to do the work, but I have the joy of seeing it and writing about it and trying to put it into the context with all the other films.
Like, as a critic then, do you ever feel that some of these movies go over the line? They do too much?
That doesn't bother me. To me, the worst thing in the world, the worst criminal or the worst monster in the world are the ones in our headlines, the child molesters. And when you come to a film, you come to an element of fun, I think. Like, they say Freddy Krueger is a child molester, but he really, you're not shown that. He really isn't. He's killing the teenagers, and therefore...
What's wrong with that craze?
To me,
The teenagers?
That's better.
I don't understand that. I think a lot... Do you have problems with that a little bit? Yeah?
Well, it seems to be a trend that got started in Friday the 13th and in the first Halloween film, and everybody's been copying that ever since.
Like every parent's dream, yeah, because difficult to deal with teenagers, and so...
In 1931, Frankenstein threw a little girl into a lake and drowned her. You know, back in the old Universal movies, these old, apparently safe, you know, softcore little movies... And I don't think we should be getting too self-righteous about what's happening in the 80s and the 90s.
Also, in the 30s, they edited out the scene of him throwing the child in the lake. Now they've reissued Frankenstein on Laserdisc where they put that scene back in.
We have a red cloth over here. Why don't we... What movie is this? Don't take it off
I
yet.
I won't take that off.
Don't take it off
It's
yet.
Red for a reason.
What movie is this from?
This is for a film coming up probably next month called Bride of Reanimator.
All right, let's take a commercial break, come back, and take a look at what's under the red cloth.
Everybody wants to lose weight quickly and easily. You have to have that one-on-one support, and also the group support and the lifestyle classes are very important. They help people by saying, I know exactly how you feel because I've been in that situation before. When we feel we've been really successful is when clients tell us, I don't remember eating any other way.
With our 50% off special, lose all the weight you want for a $92.50 service fee. Call 1-800-76-JENNY.
Alpha Beta shoppers are finding when the new sign went up, the prices came down.
For the last year, I shopped at Alpha Beta, and now that it's switched over to Lucky's, I find a significant reduction in my weekly grocery bill. It's important that I have quality and affordable prices, and I find that I get both of that when I shop at Lucky's.
Alpha Beta is now Lucky. We think you'll like the change.
At Brunner's President's Day sale, you'll save at least 33% on all advertised specials.
Bravo.
Including the best brand names in the furniture business.
Splendid.
And when you can save at least 33% on the best at Brunner's, why settle for a discount on mediocrity?
Why indeed?
So check out the ads and come on in.
The President's Day sale, February 16th to 19th at Brunner's. There's no other furniture store like it.
I agree. He agrees.
Having one cat can certainly be a lot of fun. Two or three cats can be even more fun. Unfortunately, having this much fun has one serious drawback. The cat box. With more than one cat, you need new Tidy Cat MC Multiple Cat Formula. Specially formulated for the extra moisture and odor problems of homes with more than one cat.
Look for my new Tidy Cat MC in the bright blue bag. Because when it comes to cats, the more the merrier. Right, guys?
Don't miss out on your chance to have a starring role in the People Are Talking audience. Call 478-KPIX to reserve your place in the limelight.
Are you having problems in your relationship? Well, we're looking for people who are thinking about breaking up and who are willing to talk about possible strategies for a successful split. We also want to hear from you if you've ever had an awful or wonderful experience while breaking off from a long-term relationship. If you can relate to any of this, give us a call at 478-KPIX. That's also the number to call to order your free seats to the only talk show in town with a live studio audience. We'd love to meet you in person, so call us now to reserve your...
Night of the Living Dead.
Howard, before we see what this is, set it up, and it's from a new movie.
Right, it's for a new film titled Bride of Reanimator, which is a sequel to The Reanimator, which was made 4 years ago. This film will be out in about a month, and it's incredibly graphic, but it's a lot of fun, though. It's laughable gore, I guess you could say.
So what has happened to this individual that we're going to see?
This is the bride. And we had a crew of like 12 people working on everything about the bride. This is just a prop head of her. This is a gag head. It did a certain thing. The head stretched apart from the body. But we had a full body makeup on this actress named Kathleen Kenmont that took 6 hours every day to put her into it. Tons of stuff.
What happens to her?
She is pieced together from dead body parts. And the main person piecing her together has the heart of his dead girlfriend. All
right. Well, without any further ado, Howard, because we can hardly wait. Okay. Oh.
So that's the bride of Reanimator.
But when we see it in the movie, it's moving and writhing and fear.
On this one, the gag is the head just stretches up.
Oh, you old gaggers, you.
You know what's awful to me is like the strings hanging off.
Yeah.
It would be all right if it was solid, but the strings
How much of that will the MPAA allow for?
Actually, I'll tell you, they were pretty kind with us on this film. Although they cut, I think, about a second and a half out of this one gag. But at the end of the film, she completely falls apart. Her head falls off. She splits at the waist. They cut out the split at the waist and the leg splitting apart.
Yes, Ralph.
There you have it.
Well, I want to ask you a question. If you think your films are so widely accepted by society, why aren't your films on TV like Frankenstein or Dracula, you know?
Well, they aren't.
Yeah.
There are standards that are applied.
ABC, NBC, Channel 2.
Richard, you might be able to answer that, being with Aaron Spelling.
Yeah, well, they have to attenuate the violent factor. Because you've got an audience where it's coming right into their home, you know, you're not opting for it. But it's all there. I mean, The Exorcist has been on, Jaws has been on, Alien has been on.
I'm not talking about Exorcist. I mean...
Films like this,
right.
Mm-hmm. There are broadcast standards that have to be subscribed to when you air something.
Like, for example, how much of the original Reanimator would really make NBC or CBS?
Not much worth showing.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So is television like Square or?
No, because you have a thing called a videotape deck, and horror movies are among the heaviest rentals at videotape shops.
And there are this cable which will show these things. I mean, I don't particularly mind not competing with game shows and soap operas.
Yolanda.
And talk shows. Go ahead.
And talk shows.
But broadcast television is about 10 years out of date, I mean, in terms of the standards.
I just had a thought. It might not initiate behavior, but it certainly validates or gives free license to.
Well, you know, if art is instructive, then there's a lot of things we shouldn't allow. Mm-hmm. You know, you can include horror in a very wide category of things that we shouldn't allow. I don't think art is instructive. Yeah. I think the premise that art is instructive has to be looked at a little more carefully.
When we come back, we're going to ask about the connection between religion, maybe, and horror movies.
Now,
right
before we go away, let me show a couple of books here, if I might. If you'll hold those, Carl, please. This is David Scow's book called Seen Red. I'm sure it's not breakfast reading. Then we have another book by David Scow called Silver Scream.
Actually, Richard and Clive, and I edited that book. It's an anthology of short stories, and Clive and Richard and I are all in that book.
All right. And then Richard has, this is your new novel.
No, that's my short story collection.
I have a novel coming out next year. Called Scars. Mm. Very prolific.
I was
going to
call it
Scab.
We'll be back. Sophisticated. Mm.
Everybody skippy dipping, scooping it or finger licking, spreading it on or maybe celery sticking. Everybody skippy dipping. People dipping for the skippy cause it's nuttier. People dipping for the skippy cause it's peanut buttier. Big people, little people, everyone, cause it's good, 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 good fun. Whoa, everybody skippy dipping. Look out! Everybody skippy dipping till it's all skipped out.
little ones weren't born to be outside. Bundle them up on the inside with Malto Meal Hot Cereal. And new Malto Meal Plus 40% Oat Bran.
National taste tests prove that Stouffer's makes the best tasting frozen pizza, thanks to the time we spend doing nothing. And we do it for a whole half hour. We do nothing while our dough rises all by itself. The secret to a crust that doesn't taste frozen. Only then is it good enough for our natural cheese and abundant toppings. So if you want the best tasting frozen pizza, there's nothing to it. Buy Stouffer's.
Friday only, 10 to 10 only. It's the Circuit City 12-hour sale. Friday only, time counts down with savings in every department. Like this VCR with 6-event 14-day timer, now just $177. And this 500-watt compact microwave oven, now a low $56. But hurry, Friday only, time really flies. At the Circuit City 12-hour sale, Friday only, 10 to 10 only.
For complete details on today's show and guests, call the People Are Talking hotline at 478-8888.
We may be what you might call disability and physically disabled, but we don't like those words because it doesn't really describe who we really are. Our disabilities are easy to spot than yours, some of yours, but everyone has some type of disability, whether it is visible or hidden. No one is perfect. We are people first, and our disabilities are second. People first of the East Bay. People are who meet monthly to discuss issues and policies that affect our lives. If for more information, call 415-525-3535.
Ron, you had a question.
Yeah, the movies like Poltergeist, Omen, others along these lines that have kind of very deep religious connotations. Have you all run into flack from the religious community about some of the things you're trying to express?
It's always interesting to go on phone-ins. And conventionally what happens on the phone-in thing when I do Larry King or something like that is that I go on Larry and about 5 to 1 in the morning a fundamentalist calls up and reads Deuteronomy down the phone to me. And I don't have a religious upbringing, but I feel like the subtext of what we're doing is very often concerned with good and evil and whether God and the devil are valid ideas in the world, whether it is possible to make those kind of judgments. I think that horror fiction is something we haven't touched upon because we've been dealing with the sensationalist aspects of it. Sometimes horror fiction can have a very considerable serious undertow. And I just on a book, I think it was up on the screen a moment ago, called The Great and Secret Show, which is very much about whether good and evil are valid ideas in the world we still live in. I think that's very important.
Yeah. We've all gotten those letters from people who are deeply concerned for our souls. I mean, we do have those people that write to us and think we've gone over the deep end.
Yeah, I'd just like to address any one of you. Do you think in today's society where it's so violent that a movie of any sort is really necessary? In other words, you really think violent movies are necessary?
I don't think any movies are necessary.
Society?
I mean, movies in general are not necessary. There has to be an eclectic selection of movies available. So in that sense, yes.
What scares you guys?
Talk shows.
Well, we found out during the commercial break that blood scares Howard.
Yeah, blood. I mean, this is all fake. People always go, well, how can you be afraid of blood?
But if this were real, you would not be.
I mean, I go to the doctors once a year.
Well, John Stanley has a book out called The Revenge of the Creature Features. It's a movie guide that you can find in the major bookstores. And this is Clive Barker's newest book, The Great and Secret Show. Thank you to all of you for being with us. Have a good weekend. Anna and I'll be back right after this. Don't go away.
The Panama invasion. Over 600 female soldiers were there. Dozens fought. But by law and policy, women are forbidden to hold combat jobs. Now, this law is coming under heavy fire. Eyewitness News' Sherry Hu takes you behind the firing lines for the battle brewing over Women in Combat. Starts Monday on Eyewitness News at 5 on Channel 5.
Now you have a choice in filing your income tax return. The old way or the new way. Rapid refund from H&R Block. The old way involves patience. With Rapid Refund, we file your federal return electronically, and you get a loan against your anticipated refund in a matter of days. And the fees can be withheld, too. Available whether Block prepares your return or not. So it's your choice. The old way or Rapid Refund from H&R Block to get your money fast.
It's New York Fabrics President's Day sale. Save 20% on all fabrics and 40% on all notions. That's right. All fashion and decorator fabrics are now 20% off. And save 40% on all thread, scissors, ribbon, any notion in the store, now through Monday only.
I love New York Fabrics. New York Fabrics. New York Fabrics. The fabulous fabric store. Sugar in the morning, sugar in the evening, sugar at supper time. They keep on adding sugar to lots of things you find.
But not to Libby's Light Fruits. Other fruits say light on the label, but Libby's Light is the only leading brand with no sugar added. Just the choicest fruits and natural fruit juices. Libby's Light, because life can be awfully sweet.
Libby's, Libby's, Libby's.
Even without the sugar.
The East Bay Center for the Performing Arts in Richmond is looking for teens who are, have been, or may soon be mothers or fathers and are willing to collectively write their story. These stories will be used for a video film project, which will be produced this spring. Teens who decide to take part will be asked to join a class designed exclusively for this project. For more information on how you can get involved, please call Reg Green at 234-5624.
Well, Monday we're going to be on a half hour earlier. We're going to be on at 9:30 because it's President's Day and the NBA basketball and all that. Mm-hmm. But you won't want to miss an arousing show. A conversation with three provocative women. The Mayflower Madam, Sydney Biddle Barrows, will join novelist Pat Booth and Beverly Sassoon with a look at sex in the 90s. Everything from sex etiquette to addiction. And then you are also going to meet Miss Terry, the transsexual candidate for mayor from Yountville. Boy, is she colorful.
Yeah. We've got the colorful Hank Plant in the Eyewitness Newsroom. Hello, Hank.
Morning, Ross. And here's what's coming up on the new news today. The latest on this wild storm making its way through Northern California. We've got word that Reno Airport is shut down because of the snow. A blizzard warning is in effect for the Lake Tahoe area. And here locally, flooding on Highway 101 near SFO. High wind warnings everywhere over the bridges. We'll have the latest on all of this at noon. Plus, sentencing of a man whose pit bull mauled a two-year-old to death. A specialist on childhood ear infections, the medical complaint of the 90s. And the War of the Trumps, all coming your way at noon. And Ross, back to you.
Thank you very much, Hank.
Buffy is with us. Buffy, a little terrier, a little guy who's 1 year old. He is a cute dog. Please, let's give him a family today so he'll have a nice weekend. He's at the Peninsula Humane Society, 340-8200. And tomorrow we have a special edition of Mac and Muttley at our nation's winter wonderland, Yosemite Park. Mac and Muttley, tomorrow night at 7, right here on Channel 5.
And as we go away, we're going to leave you with some more scenes of our three shows at the Circle Star Center. We want to thank our audience and all the wonderful people who participated in it. We hope you enjoy it. We'll see you Monday.
See you Monday at 10. Goodbye.
Goodbye.